Each year, as things start warming up again, I'm eager to hit the ground running and get out into the fields and forests to take macros. And this summer, I've got a new lens in my backpack, the Laowa 100mm 2-to-1 macro. This lens has been out for a while now, but this particular lens is a bit unique. It's a gift from Laowa, a pre-release Pentax K-mount unit, and not just that, it has mechanical aperture coupling, which is a first for me and my Pentax. And they put my name on it too, quite an honor. The aperture ring is nice and clicky, and around back is this, the welcome sight of an aperture control lever. Now my camera knows what aperture the lens is set to, and keeps the aperture open for me while I'm composing through the viewfinder, making seeing and focusing much easier. Seven aperture blades produce nice septagonal bokeh. A bit heavy with a smooth metal finish, it has a solid robustness about it. One minor gripe though is this UV filter business. It's really just to protect the void created by the internal focusing, and without it I could totally see a wayward jumping spider leaping in, and that can be a sad scenario. Working distance is a comfortable 75 millimeters or so at 2-to-1, and at that 2x magnification, if you're on an APS-C sensor like me, that translates to about 12 millimeters of horizontal frame coverage. Alright, let's zoom in on the eye of Hideo Noguchi here to test sharpness. Wide open at f2.8, the image is really sharp. Clean, contrasty, no chromatic aberration, nothing. Just a beautiful image. Stopping down to f8 looks great, and even f16 holds up with surprisingly little diffraction. But how does it compare to my other lenses? Here's the Laowa 100, my old Vivitar on a teleconverter, and finally, the Laowa 60mm. Comparing all three, cropped right into the center, I was a bit shocked at just how soft my usual Vivitar setup looks. The Laowa 100mm is the clear winner here. Alright, let's get out in the field and shoot some spiders.
Section of background, maybe some foliage a little bit closer to her, so I don't have just a flat black background. So that's a pretty dark background. One thing I can do is open up my aperture a little bit and drag the shutter a little bit, and I can let in a little bit more light, and then maybe I can get a little bit of color in the background. And this is often how I come across jumping spiders. I'll just spot them out in the open and then try to carefully approach them from there. If gentle enough, sometimes they'll sit still and relaxed, easy to shoot. But many are excitable, like this male heiress repeatedly hopping at the lens, or this Pacamia wildly waving around his second pair of legs like antenna. Learning how to work with salticids just takes time, and even the excitable jumpers can be photographed with enough time and patience. I love the stripy patterns on this male Maiva inclemens. This portrait here is just one of dozens of failed attempts. Some jumping spiders are very small, like this Pellegrina galathea. Luckily, I caught them while mating, providing a great opportunity to get in close with the Laowa and try a small focus stack at 2x magnification. Considering just how tiny these jumpers are, I'm pretty impressed with how much detail the Laowa was able to resolve at 2x. Initially, this big guy did not want to calm down. running and leaping about in the open. But after letting him get up inside this old leaf, he kind of powered down and relaxed a bit, swaddled inside the curve of the leaf. Gently opening the leaf to get my flash diffuser over him and angling up against the sky, the shot came out all right with lots of detail to crop in. This summer I've been lucky in finding quite a few female Paraphytopus in the woods. This is a beautiful and variable species with metallic iridescent green scales and vibrant orange patches along down the sides of the abdomen. Here she's feeding on a pirate spider, I believe. And here's a stacked portrait of another smaller female with even more of those awesome golden orange and yellow scales. Nestled up into the moss on the side of this tree was a nice looking harvestman, and a great opportunity to try a small focus stack as the harvestman was lying still. Four shots at F10 made for a real sharp image, and one of the best views I've had of these defensive gland openings called oospores. When possible, I try to vary up my bug hunting locations and sample from varied habitats to see new animals I might not see otherwise. And this summer, I've really enjoyed hitting up some local ponds and lakes to spot odonates, the damselflies and dragonflies. And I usually pass on shooting odonates with my shorter focal length macros, but the 100mm focal length of Lawa has been pretty helpful. First, it allows for more space to approach them if they're skittish. And additionally, the longer focal length helps isolate them from the background. Now, there's a lot of different ways to find animals, and a lot of methods to spot and collect bugs, but I like going slow and just letting my eyes drift across the plants and earth to spot things. And watch out for turtles. They can be tough to spot when your mind is searching for other things. And although pretty obvious in this clip here, I definitely walked by a few of these little katydids before noticing one. Here I've positioned one of my flash heads out beyond the katydid and pointed it back for some backlighting to highlight how delicate and translucent they are. I realize not everyone may be interested in this lens for the same reasons I am. It focuses to infinity and could be great for portraits, herping, landscapes, anything. It's not solely a macro lens. But in my case, at least, I like going out into the field and documenting every bug I find, big or small. So they're not always conveniently sized for macro photography. Each subject can require a unique magnification, aperture, or approach to lighting. Having a lens with a combination of a comfortable focal length, infinity focus, 2x magnification, and aperture coupling has honestly been a bit of a revelation for me and really changed things, especially for taking macros in the field, as I can actually see through this coupled aperture, which has really increased my percentage of focused shots. You lose a lot of light at higher magnifications, and I've become completely reliant on my flash to illuminate most of my macros. I'm in a constant battle with sunlight. I don't always want this continuous, often undiffused light source bleeding into my exposures. But just to break my usual habits, I've been opening this lens up and shooting with natural light more, with fast exposure times and no flash. There's almost a clinical pristineness to the images. There's really no optical flaws or aberrations distracting from the subject itself. Some animals almost become myths in my mind. Wild sightings I might have seen once but was unable to document, leaving me with just a story of something amazing. One of those animals for me was Laphria latta, a huge hairy robber fly in my area I spotted years ago but was somehow never able to photograph. They're absolute beasts and can be skittish, loudly buzzing off if disturbed. But this summer, I succeeded in getting some nice stills of a few individuals with the lawa, fulfilling a dream several years in the making. I was even able to crank the lens up to 2x and get this portrait, highlighting those beautiful compound eyes and mystacks. So yeah, with the help of this lens, I'm taking more macros than ever and nailing the focus a lot more too. But I'm not sure my photography is getting any better, and in a weird way, I feel as though I'm a bit spoiled now and have grown soft. I no longer struggle with reversed lenses or extension tubes, really, which are still great options, I should point out, if you're making a lightweight or a budget-minded macro setup. Because this lens is not the lightest or cheapest lens out there. It's a luxury I'm not sure I would have gotten for myself, but now that I have access to it, I would be really, really sad to lose it. Wrapping things up, I'd like to thank all the people on iNaturalist that have helped me with identifications this summer. I wouldn't know what half these things are without their help. And finally, I'd like to thank the folks at Venus Optics for putting together and sending this lens for review. It's not just a generous gift, it's become one of the most valuable tools for doing what I love. And of course, if you'd like to get the lens for yourself, head to venuslens.net. It comes in a wide variety of mounts, with the Canon, Nikon, and upcoming Pentax versions having aperture coupling. To keep up with my work, follow me on Twitter at Thomas Shahan, and if you'd like, subscribe to this channel for more upcoming videos. Thanks!